Nowadays, in the interconnected world that we live in, video calling has become a part of everyday life. Especially in 2020, due to current events, many people have found themselves working from home, using Zoom or Skype. Do people still use Skype to connect with coworkers? And the amount of video calling apps seems to be growing every day. FaceTime, Google Duo, Microsoft Teams, just to name a few. And when you fire up one of these applications and join a video call, you probably don't think much about the massive amount of innovation that was required to make it all possible. Because video calling isn't a new idea at all. Sure, it's become more mainstream in the past couple of decades, but would you believe me if I told you that back in 1992, there was a device that you could buy that enabled you to make video calls over your existing phone line? It's called the AT&T Videophone 2500. And I've got one of them that's been sitting in its box ever since it was manufactured. That's right, this thing is brand new, and we're gonna be opening it up for the first time in today's video. This thing cost me about $200. Yeah, I paid $200 for a landline phone in 2020 because, well, that's what we do on this channel. Before we get to the video phone itself, I want to talk briefly about the history of video calling in general, because there's a lot more to it than you might think. This video phone from 1992 was in no way the first implementation of video calling. The idea is actually as old as the telephone itself. In the late 1870s, the idea of the telephonoscope was conceived, a device that could transmit sound and light over phone lines. It was often mentioned in science fiction works from the time, like this illustration that depicts two parents talking to their daughter using speaking tubes. Yes, that's what those things are called, while also being able to see her. Now, this video is not going to cover the entire history of video telephony because that would need an entire full-length episode. Instead, we're going to be focusing on AT&T's many attempts at creating a video phone system that could be used by consumers in the US. AT&T began experimenting with this idea as early as 1927 when their research and development division, Bell Labs, created a prototype of a video phone system. It was later publicly demonstrated when Herbert Hoover, then the Secretary of Commerce, gave a speech to an audience in New York City from over 200 miles away in Washington, D.C., and they could see him. It was extremely impressive, though it required an entire room full of equipment to operate properly. And it was only a one-way video call, meaning that Hoover could not see the audience he was talking to. It wouldn't be until the 1960s when the first publicly available video phone in the US was unveiled. At the 1964 World's Fair, AT&T set up an exhibit featuring the Picture Phone, a video phone that anybody could use. You just had to wait in line for a while. On the other side of the country, AT&T had set up another Picture Phone exhibit at Disneyland in California. Picture Phone booths at these two locations were able to make calls to each other. So once it was your turn to make a call, you'd spend a few minutes chatting with the random person on the West Coast who just happened to be in one of the booths the same time as you. It was an extremely revolutionary demonstration, and later that year, AT&T set up Picture Phone booths in three major US cities, Chicago, Washington DC, and New York, enabling anyone to place video calls. But you couldn't just walk up and place a phone call like at a regular payphone. You had to reserve a time. Plus, it was very expensive. A video call from New York to Washington, D.C. cost $16 for just 3 minutes of call time. That's $134 today, adjusted for inflation. And it was even more expensive to call Chicago. Needless to say, it wasn't very popular, causing AT&T to close the booths just 4 years later in 1968. AT&T would then experiment with the video phone concept for the next few decades. They even created newer models of the Picture Phone, but none of them were ever commercially successful. And that leads us to what we have in front of us today. In 1992, AT&T introduced the Videophone 2500. It was their last attempt at creating a commercially successful video telephone. And it vastly improved in the cost area compared to previous video phones. Since it could place video calls over your existing phone line, it didn't cost anything extra to make video calls, which was great. The cost of the phone itself, however, was still a problem. It sold for $1,499. That's over $2,700 today. So just like all of AT&T's other attempts at a commercially successful video phone, this one didn't sell very well either. But somebody bought this one and left it in its package for the past almost three decades. So let's unbox it for the first time and see what it's all about. All right, so here it is, everybody. Check it out. We've got the AT&T Videophone 2500. On the right side here, you have the original price tag. Now, this is not the original price. This is actually a discounted price. In 1993, AT&T dropped the price of this phone to $999.95, which was still expensive, but it was a little bit cheaper than what it was originally. So without any further ado, guys, let's open this thing up. So we're gonna just take this piece out here, open it up, and we just gotta do this, I believe. Yep, this is gonna come out. So here it is. Now, yeah, there was no tape on this tab here or any plastic wrap on the exterior. Not sure if it originally came with it. It doesn't look like there was tape on here, when I opened it up. But you can see here that, like, this is still taped here. We've got these things, like, this is the handset. It's in, like, a plastic bag here. It looks to be new. So we're gonna go ahead and take out the documentation here. So here is the Videophone 2500 owner's manual. Here is a quick reference guide that was just tucked inside of there. So this just gives you some, yeah, like brief information about it, how to install it. And on the back here, we've got telephone operation, which just tells you, you know, how to make a phone call, use speakerphone, adjust the volume, all that good stuff. So we're going to set that aside and we're going to take out the, this appears to be the handset and the video screen. So we'll take this out. Or is this the entire thing? Oh, this is the entire thing. Okay, well, there's this box down here, which probably contains the power supply, I'm guessing. We'll take out this other box here. This is much lighter, so we will set this down here. And yeah, guys, this looks to be sealed. I mean, that tape has not been cut, and it doesn't look like there's any, like, tape over the original tape. Right here, as I said, we have the handset. Man, check this out. So here it is. Here's the phone itself. So we're gonna set this aside. All right, so there's our little plastic covering for the video display. Check that out. Oh my gosh, that is so cool. So there's the video display right there. And all we gotta do is just take off this plastic covering the phone itself. So there it is, guys. Now we just gotta obviously get the handset, and we obviously need to get the cord as well, which is gonna be in this other box over here, I'm guessing. So let's just set that aside and we'll open up this box right here. Okay, so yeah, this is the power supply. Oh my gosh, this thing is I think this is a pretty large power supply. So take that. Got a cardboard piece here. And then, yeah, look at the size of this brick right here, guys. Man. So yeah, this is definitely a pretty large power supply. For comparison's sake, here is a computer mouse. So you can kind of see what size that we're looking at here. So we'll take this out. This is what plugs into the phone, obviously, right here. And then you've got the other end that goes into the wall, which is just a, this is actually a three-prong, yeah, like what you would see on a computer power supply. It's got the same connector there. And last but not least, at least I would assume, this is your... Oh, you got a battery. Oh my gosh. I wonder when this battery expired. This is a 9-volt battery. January 97. Oh my gosh. Best if installed. I mean, the battery looks like brand new. But yeah, best if used by January 97. Man. So there's a super old Duracell battery. So according to the manual here, and this is kind of what I suspected, the battery is used to store memory and video settings if you lose power. Obviously, it's not required to power on the phone because it gets power from the wall. So you've got a phone cord right here, a standard RJ11 phone cord. So there you go. And you have the cord to go from the handset to the base. So all that's left to do, guys, is get this thing plugged in and see if it works.
after all these years.
So obviously the main thing that makes this phone different from any other regular telephone on the market at this point is going to be the video screen right here. Now when you saw it in the package, you may have noticed that the screen was down like this. So it actually folds down like this and it becomes almost flush with this, with the handset right here. It's not exact, but it comes pretty close. So this makes it easier, if you're moving or whatever and you want to store it temporarily, you can very easily fold it and put it back in the box. But when you're ready to use it and when you would have it set up, you would obviously want the screen to be up like this. You can probably tell from this, circular cutout here that the screen moves around. So if you wanted to maybe have it like this or more, to the left, you can do that. So when you're ready to make a call, what you're obviously going to do is pick up the handset and you'll probably hear those beeps there. So that's to kind of let you know that the video screen is active. So this is what you see. Now it's saying low battery because I don't have a 9-volt battery in there because again, this one expired in 1997. It's going to say that, and that might actually be what those beeps are. It might be letting you know that there's a low battery. The nice thing, aside from the video calling, what's nice is as you dial a number, it will show the number on the screen. And if you notice when I first picked it up, it said that there was a number in redial. So this is just the number, and even if you don't make a call, like I didn't just make a call and I typed in 212 and I hung up the phone and I picked it back up, that's going to be what is in redial. So that way, if you had called somebody, so let's say that I, type in a number here and I call somebody and then I hang up the phone, if I want to call them back, you have a redial feature right here. And, there were a lot of phones from around this time that had this. It was a very common feature. But since this phone has a video screen, it will actually show you the number that's stored in redial right as you pick up the handset. So I can hit redial if I want to dial the number and it will go ahead and dial the number right there. Now, unfortunately, because I don't have home phone service, we're not going to be able to actually make a call on this thing. But it's going to work just like any other phone would. It's going to be a standard telephone call, nothing special. We cannot place a video call on this thing, and I'll talk a little bit about why. I'm sure you guys can probably already tell a little bit later on in the video. But let's say that it was 1992, and I just went out and purchased the AT&T video phone, and I know someone who also went out and purchased the AT&T video phone. How would I make a video call to them? Well, the first thing I'm going to want to do is reveal the camera. You can see there's this cover for it right here. There's this slider on the top of the video display. If I slide that to the left, it will reveal the camera lens right there. They included this really for privacy and for peace of mind. They actually advertise this on the box or in the manual. Then this way you can really, like when you're not making a video call and you don't want this camera looking at you, you can switch it to close. And that's way the camera lens will be covered. So yeah, pretty nice. So next thing we're gonna do is actually pick up the handset, and it's going to come up once again. It's gonna say low battery, and it's gonna have the previous number that I dialed in redial. So let's say that I wanted to dial that number, so I'll hit redial here. And then once it dials the number, what I'm gonna do is hit the video button right here. So I'm gonna hit that, and now it's gonna say preparing to send voice and picture, press flash to cancel video. Now it's gonna fail here momentarily because number one, this is not connected to a phone line, and even if it was, I don't know anybody who owns one of these to actually make a video call, and I don't know if this works over like a VoIP phone line or if it requires a POTS line. I don't have either, so we're not going to really be able to actually demonstrate the video calling functionality, unfortunately. But what's nice is you don't have to actually make a video call to test out the camera. So I'm going to go ahead and hang up here. And you may have noticed this little self-view button right here on the phone. What does this do? Well, it activates the camera. So it says, please wait for image to change, and then here is the camera in all of its glory right here. This is kind of like a mirror, essentially. This is not what we would be seeing if we had actually made a video call. This is what the other person would see because this is what my camera is seeing. But this gives you a look at just how poor that the frame rate is. Like if I were to wave my hand in front of the camera, you can see just how long it takes to update. There is definitely a lot of latency, and the frame rate on this, it goes up to 10 frames per second. It's not even a constant 10 frames per second. That's the highest that it can go. It's very, very laggy. There's a lot of latency, and the frame rate is very, very low. But keep in mind, and there's also a little timeout there, so I had it on for too long, and it just shuts off for us. But yeah, keep in mind, this was 1992, and it was sending this video signal over a phone line. Yeah, this is what the video calling experience would be like on the AT&T Videophone 2500. So definitely not the greatest, but this is what you're going to get if you purchase this phone at the time. So that's the Videophone 2500. It certainly is not perfect, but still very revolutionary. So why did it fail? Well, I think it's pretty obvious. We already talked about the cost of these phones. They were expensive, so most people didn't buy them. But this created another problem that discouraged people from buying the Videophone even more. And that was usage. Because for you to actually make a video call from this phone, you had to know somebody who also had a Videophone. Otherwise, it wasn't possible. And because again, most people didn't buy these, there was no point in buying one even if you had the money because you couldn't use it. It was just an overpriced telephone at that point. And even if you had one or two friends that had one, was it really worth paying $1,500 to see a tiny 10 frames per second image of the person while talking? I don't think so. I think most people had no problem settling for just voice calls. And that is why the AT&T Videophone 2500, along with all of AT&T's other Videophone attempts, was not commercially successful. And that's kind of a bummer, because this device was pretty ahead of its time. Who knows, maybe if it was introduced in the late 90s at a more affordable price, maybe it would have flown off the shelves and become a must-have household appliance. But as with pretty much every other piece of tech that was ahead of its time, its price is what dug its grave. And today, it lives on as a testament to the extraordinary amount of innovation that went into something that we all do every single day. That's all for today's video. I want to thank you all very much for watching. If you enjoyed this episode, be sure to give it a like and get subscribed. And as always, I will see you all in the next video.